Hello, so I'm gonna ask you to work in ArcMap for this tutorial because the layers that we're working with are relatively small, and also because you can access our catalog directly from ArcMap. For me, it just popped up with our catalog ready here on the right. If it's not that like that for you, remember you can just access our catalog that way, and remember how to dock it. And so the first step in the project is usually going to be making sure that we can access the data that we just found. So you can access it, for me at least, because I did this last time, I can still access everything through here. If you can't, just remember that you can connect to the folder this way and go ahead and navigate to where you put the data. And I'm going to go ahead and drill all the way down to GG120 weekend 1 and say OK. And now there's that water tank with our data. And then also what I'd like to show you is that if you go over to File and say Save As, I'm sorry this type is so small. I just looked to see if I could make it larger, and this is I think what we're going to be working with. So anyway, but if you say Save As, this should pop up, and then if you navigate to this folder that we just made, Weekend 1, and then save your MXD as weekend one, workspace or map, whatever you want to call it, and say save. What it does is it automatically makes your home directory where the directory it makes your home directory the directory where you just saved your map. Does that make sense? And so that's often why it's nice to save your map into the directory that has your data. Because then now we don't even have to really look at folder connections anymore. We seem to be able to work just right here and we'll be able to access our data. Okay, so let's go ahead and drop this in, and we see this little backwards E that represents the dorm. Don't worry if you don't get this great kind of neon green on kind of burnt orange that I've got. The key thing is just that you have the same values, ones and zeros, not colors. And so what we'd like to do is figure out for every single cell moving away from this E in all directions, we'd like to figure out how far we are from the nearest part of this E, if that makes sense. And so to do this, I'm going to first show you something that may not work, and then I'd like to first understand why it didn't work. And so I'm going to bring in ArcToolbox. And actually, I'm going to let ArcToolbox hang out over there because I think it's easier for us to work with search. So we're looking for a tool called Euclidean Distance. And you'll see that that's in Spatial Analyst. And so if I click on this, now I think at this point, we've gone through how if you get a message saying that you don't have permission to use this, you should be able to fix that, right? Because you have to get permission to use Spatial Analyst as an extension the first time you use a tool from Spatial Analyst. I think we've all moved beyond that. But anyway, if you have a glitch at this point, I think you're going to be able to fix it. So let's just keep moving forward here. Euclidean distance. So what I need to put in is an input, and so my input is the frosh norm. I'm going to wait for it to think about that, and then I have to kick something out. So I'm going to make sure that I navigate to my home directory, and in my home directory, I'm going to say, okay, this is my Othello1 underscore distance from dorm. And if I say save, and then the maximum distance, I'm going to leave blank. The output cell size, I'm going to leave 1 because that's the same as the input. The output direction raster, I'm going to leave blank, and I'm going to say okay. And Arc's never going to kind of pass up the opportunity to leave you disappointed. And so what you get here is a raster that is entirely made up of zeros. Curiously, many different kinds of zeros, but it's actually all just one, it's just this one zero. This is good times here. I don't know really how to explain that. What I want you to see though is why did we get this from this? And the basic idea is that what Arc is going to try to do is calculate the Euclidean distance of like this little cell down here from the nearest cell But the problem is it's not just basically from the nearest cell that represents E, it's from the nearest cell that is not no data, right? Remember that weird double negative? So the problem is that this little guy, or this cell location right here, is what? Where's my identity tool? Boom. This little guy is 0, and this little guy is 1. So every location on this raster is 0 distance from something that's not no data, right? Because right now we're using 0 for our background, and Arc is mistaking 0 as part of our foreground, if that makes sense. So the first thing that we're going to need to do to get Euclidean distance to work in this case, you may not need to do this every time, but you always want to check whenever you're using the Euclidean distance tool, you want to make sure that no data, that you're not using 0 as your background value, if that makes sense. So I'm going to use a tool called Reclassify it doesn't matter if you use it from 3D Analyst or from Spatial Analyst. I'm just going to use Spatial Analyst because if you guys ask to use it from 3D Analyst, you're going to get an error saying that you don't have permission to use 3D Analyst because it's another one of these extensions. So I tend to just, if I have the option, use tools that are in an extension that I've already kind of gone through that step of asking permission to use. Otherwise, I'm just going to be clicking more. And my whole thing is like, I'm on this campaign to reduce clicking in a world where clicking is kind of like how you make it's how you move. So input raster in this case is going to still be this frosh norm. But then here's my bit. I'm going to take my 0 and I'm going to make that capital N O capital D ta, right? No data. And then I'm going to leave my 1s and I'm going to actually, it doesn't matter. They could become 2. I'm just going to leave them as 1. Or even better, what happens if I just delete that? So that I'm just going 0 to no data and no data to no data. And what I'm saying basically is that if it's a 1, leave it alone. Does that make sense? And then if I go over to here, I'm going to say, okay, Othello 2, this is no background. Or I can say this is the first year dorm, no background. Right? And now if I say OK, it's going to kind of tell me it's that green stuff. Let's just look at it. Let's look at the green stuff here. So this is kind of in the lobster here. The green stuff is telling me that my data classification, the ranges, doesn't encapsulate the entire range of values in the input. I believe that what this is telling me. So it's saying, hey, just so you know, we're going to run this process, but the ranges that you told us to reclassify leave holes so that there are some data values that are slipping through unreclassified in this reclassify scheme. Does that make sense? And I'm okay with that because what we got is we preserved our 1. This is what kind of slipped through. And then everything else is now no data, right? So if I click here, what had been 0 is now no data, but what had been 1 remained kind of stuck around. Is that so far so good? So then what I'd like to do is go back into here and say Euclidean distance and bring it back up. And now my input is going to be not this Froshstorm, but this Froshstorm. And my output is going to be Othello 3 distance. I'm really kind of typing like a pro here. Distance from dorm good. And say save. And then again, maximum distance is nothing. Output cell size is 1. Output direction raster is nothing. And if I say OK and wait, and it looks good, and time elapsed. And now if I zoom out, and the easiest way to zoom to full extent is to hit this kind of globe up top. I get this cool, I hope you got the same pattern, and I hope you've got a little GD going on in the background, but it's a kind of a nice little tie-dye that you get out of here. And it's basically classifying distance. So these are continuous values, but they're being displayed in this classified system, which is what gives it this kind of little bit of a ring or a kind of tie-dye effect. And the alternative way of looking at it is to go well, let's just, I hate to lose that. So I'm going to copy this layer, and then I'm going to go ahead and paste the layer back in there. And so now if I double click on this and I go to stretched and go to some colorful palette, that's, let's say okay, right? So these are showing you that these are continuously varying values as you move away from the dorm. And just notice the last thing here is that I just copied and pasted this layer into my table of contents. But if you go over here and refresh, you'll notice that I've still got only one version of it over here. And this is a key kind of distinction to make or to be aware of, that our catalog is where it's where the data live, right? So this is where you're storing your data files. Table of contents and layers are where you're displaying those values, right? And so here I'm just using two different methods to display the same file. Is that fair? So this is how things are displayed, this is how things are stored, and that's a, that's, and be aware that there's a difference there. Like the way that we store data versus the way that we display it is are kind of handled differently. Is that fair? Hopefully that's not too confusing. We can talk about that. Okay, so now at this point, I'm just going to kind of save my map, because even though I've saved my files over here, by saving the map, I'm saving the way that I'm displaying those files. Does that make sense? Okay, I'm gonna cut this one and start the next one.